Yes, well, very good morning to all. I am Professor Muralidhara, Assistant Professor, Soundarya College of Law. Today my topic is about United Nations of Organization. Friends, we know that the international organization, United Nations of Organization, is working like a world parliament which can resolve the issues which is arising between the countries or the member nations of the United Nations. And today, I'll be discussing about the background of United Nations of Organization, how it is origin, and coming to the who are the persons and personalities who are cause for the establishment of United Nations, and coming to the next portion, that is aims and objectives, organs of United Nations of Nations. So later I'll also discuss with you about the achievements as well as the failures of the United Nations of Organization. Friends, let me start with a brief introduction. What was the reason why it was came up and why it was charted out by the head of the prime ministers as well as the presidents of different big countries of this world? Friends, we are all knew that the Second World War was the first one foremost reason for the establishment on draft of the United Nations of Organization. Then what happened during the Second World War? First and Second World War was the major cause for the economic depression as well as the crisis in the, not only in terms of finance, but also in terms of various development of activities. So that's why the former president of America, that is Frederick Roosevelt, Winston Churchill of Prime Minister of United Kingdom, Joseph Stalin, the president of USSR, that's previous United Social Soviet Russia, these three people were sat together in the San Francisco and they decided to prevent the Third World War, because they are knew that the great loss was happened after the Second World War, not only for the developed countries, even for the underdeveloped countries. So therefore, in the year 1945, especially in the month of August, they had a meeting in the San Francisco, USA. There they decided to establish one international organization which could control the upcoming war, that is World War, and other activities. In this sequence, on 24th October 1945, the founders like Franklin Roosevelt, President of United States of America, Winston Churchill, the former Prime Minister of United States, and the Joseph Stalin, the President of Union Soviet Socialist Russia, they planned and they took up and drafted the draft and charter of the United Nations at San Francisco. In this event, along with these three members and member countries, 51 countries were present and they signed for the draft which was prepared by the San Francisco conference in the year 1945. With this, I would like to share one more very important information, that is also about the member countries. Friends, I was mentioning that only these three people and the presidents and heads of the three big states of this world has struggled and tried to establish the world organization, which is also known as the parliament in the world. Along with this, so India was one of the member, that is founder member of the country. You might ask question, sir, how India was a part of this? Because at that time, still India was under the colonial system of this England. See, friends, here one thing you should understand, even that colonial system and colonial influence, India participate as an independent as well as the sovereign country to sign for the agreement and draft which was framed by the leaders. Including India, as I mentioned, there were 51 members in the conference. On all that 51 members has signed for the basic draft and charter of this UNO. Then coming to the origin, as I mentioned, on 24th October 1945, by signing 51 countries including India, the UN has established and its headquarters in the New York City. And one more important information which I want to share with you, that is about United Nations. Then who has suggested that name or World Parliament? What was the reason behind this? So here we should remember and respect Franklin Roosevelt, who suggested the name for this organization as the United Nations. Okay, and let's move on. What are the main aims and objects of this institution or the agency called the World Parliament. Here there are four important objectives as well as the aims of the organization. That is, number one, to maintain international peace and security. Number one. Number two, to develop the friendly relationship among the nations. Third one, to achieve international cooperation among the member countries. And fourth one, to be a centric of organizing the actions of the nations. These are the four objectives. Friends, let me explain one by one. What is the idea or the intention of the leaders like Franklin Roosevelt or any other leader to establish this organization? In that terms, there is first and foremost object of this institution says that international peace and security. See, till now we have many issues, crises, disputes between countries and even the World Organization. With all this, still now we are not ready for any war in terms of Third World War or any other thing, because we don't want to fight with any other country, because not only, you know, UNO, but also for the development as well as the economic reasons. So that's why these people has kept first aim as a international, because they don't want to consider or they don't want to be a part of the international war or the world war. So that's why they said that my intention or the UN intention is just to not only stop war, to prevent and secure the peace among the member countries. And coming to second one, to develop friendly relations among the nations. Friends, here one thing we should understand, that it is not just to sign for an agreement saying or we are all friends and other things, but also it is very important to maintain that friendly relationship between the all member countries. Just I want to share one information here. We have 192 countries in this UN today. Among these countries, they have some disputes, ideological issues between the countries, but still we are all friends. We are sharing the technical assistance as well as the financial assistance among all the member countries. It shows that still the UN is one of the agency or organization who is promoting the friendly nations among the, or friendly nature among the member countries. And let me go for second one, third one, to achieve international cooperation. Friends, here the statement or the aim says that it's promoting or to achieve international cooperation. How to achieve this cooperation? Do you think that the countries will share their benefit or their income or any in terms with other nations? No, but still member countries says that we are all cooperating, we are all sharing our technical assistance as well as the other things. For example, recently Mr. Modi, as the Prime Minister of this country, when America requested we export the medicine to America to fight against the COVID-19. This is what shows and proves that we are still in the cooperation method. And coming to the fourth one, to be a center for harmonizing the actions of the nations. Today, countries like Pakistan, Afghanistan, or some of the African states, or it might be China, may say that we are all independent, we have sovereign, we must take our own decision and other things. But still, so the UN will cooperate, and they are the person who is coordinating as well as the organizing the activities which is around the nations of the countries. So these are the four very important objects as well as the aims of the UN. Before going to the organs of the United Nations, friends, let me tell you the other very important informations about the UN. So after they discussing all this, now I have a doubt that about what are the languages they speak or they use for official purpose. The Charter 1 of the United Nations has clearly mentioned five important languages which is commonly used among the member countries. That is Arabic, English, Spanish, Chinese as well as French. These are the five important languages which are regularly using and every member country can use in the administration of the UNO. Then what about administration purpose or in writing form? When it comes to secretary and its activities, that is day-to-day administration of the UNO, there are two languages which is commonly used. One is English, because it is a common language among all the countries, and even the French also. So these two are the official languages which used by the secretariat for the day-to-day administration. Friends, let's move on the organs of the United Nations of organization. Here, the UN has clearly mentioned in its charter, there are six important organs, namely General Assembly, Security Council, International Court of Justice, the Economic and Social Council, fifth, the Trusteeship Council, and last, the Secretariat. Friends, let me explain one by one. What is General Assembly? What is our duty? The General Assembly is like a parliament of the world, because every member country have the membership, and yearly once they'll meet to discuss for the various actions and problems which has arise between the countries. So that's why this General Assembly is known as the World Parliament. And what is the intention? How the membership will take in, or who can take the membership in the General Assembly? Every member country, that is 192 members of the UN, also the member of this General Assembly. Then another very important thing is, in the General Assembly, every member country can send five members as a representatives. But when it comes to voting purpose, every country have only one vote. There is no voting right for all five members. Only these people can, or countries can send up to five members, but voting rights, only one vote, means one country, one vote. This is the principle. And what is the main object, as well as the function of the General Assembly? The General Assembly is the World Parliament, as well as these people will recommend the General Secretary, who is the head for the Secretariat. With the advice of General Assembly, the Security Council will appoint the Secretary General. Right now, we have the General, that is Secretary General from Portugal, that is Antonio Guterres, is the present Secretary General, and in order is the ninth person, and his term is 5 years. I mean, Secretary General will elect from the on the advice of General Assembly for the five years, that is 5 years term. And coming to the Security Council, so Security Council is one of the most powerful organ, as well as the who act exactly like the executive of the government. Then what is the duty, or who are all the members? The duty is to secure the country extraordinarily. Like I was mentioning in the aims and objectives, that is in the first word I was saying, international peace and security. This was exclusively done by Security Council. Unless Security Council permission or approval, no member country of this UN cannot walk on this, the international peace and security. This is how the Security Council will control over the other organization or other agencies of UN. So the Security Council are, two parts. One is the permanent members, the other one is non-permanent members. Then who are the permanent members? The five permanent members. The five members are United States of America, England, France, Russia, and China. These are the five countries who are having a permanent membership of the Security Council. And as well as, you must know, and the one more best information, that these all five countries, that is America, England, France, Russia, and China, having veto power. Veto means negative power. They have power to control or to cancel any decision which is made by any of its organization. This is what the power. That's why even today, countries like India, we are fighting with the other nation like China to get this permanent membership of the Security Council. This is one part. The other one part is, that's non-permanent member. See, non-permanent member are 10 members. We are India, that's India, we are also one of the member of that non-permanent council. Means, with the advice of General Assembly, the 10 non-permanent members will elect to the Security Council. So here there is a bifurcation. Friends, I want to clarify the information exactly about Security Council. As I was mentioning, it is a 5 members who are permanent, and non-permanent are, that is divided. Please let me read out that how they are divided. Is this 10 members are regionally divided into different countries. Yes, friends, let me continue. And in this regard, let me clarify that the membership of the Security Council, just I was telling about the 5 permanent members, here I would like to clarify on non-permanent members. Here this non-permanent members are like Afro-Asian continent will be 5 members, Latin America continent will 2 member, West European and other nations will be 2, lastly East European will be 1. Like that, the membership of non-permanent members of the Security Council is divided. Coming to the International Court of Justice, The headquarters of International Court of Justice is located at the Netherland capital city, that is Haag. And here the judges will be 15, and that 15 members will elect for the term of 9 years. With the recommendation of the Security Council, the General Assembly will nominate. And the job of the International Court of Justice, as the name itself says, that it is very pure and clearly says that working for the, you know, deciding the judgments. And coming to the last point of the judge, that is International Court of Justice, it also works as a advisory functions and advisory organ of the any all its agencies, that is, that might be General Assembly or Security Council or even any other agency or the organ of the United Nations. And coming to the fourth one, that's Economic and Social Council. See, here there are 54 members, friends, and that 54 members also elect from the General Assembly. And what is the intention of this agency or the organ, that is Economic and Social? The intention or the main aim of this agency or organ is to promote the livelihood and standard of living of every citizen of this world. This is our first and foremost objective of this organ. And coming to the Trusteeship Council, the fifth very important organ of the United Nations is Trusteeship Council. In this regard, let me read out what are the main objectives. Here, the Trusteeship is the agency where it promotes the friendship, friendly relationship, as well as the peace and security among the nations. So, the Trusteeship Council will work in terms of promoting the international peace and security among all the members of this CALD. And coming to the last, that is very important organ of the United Nations, that is Secretariat. Friends, the Secretariat is working like exactly the chief administrative branch, where it's located in the headquarters, that is New York. In this New York, the Secretary General, who is appointed by the General Assembly with the advice of Security Council, definitely he will work as a chief administrative officer. So just I was mentioning the Guterres, Antonio Guterres was the present and the ninth Secretary General of this Secretariat, and he is working for the promotion and coordinating the nations. Friends, let me read out what are the functions which definitely he will carry out for the promotion and prevent the war. Here the promotion in terms of peace and security among all the members. Here the secretary will definitely work for the promotion of the peace in the member nations. In this regard, he will work on the administrative peacekeeping operations. Yes. Today we will not come to know that what is exactly happening among member countries or the countries of this world. So that what the UN will do, they will appoint one commission or operation which is headed by the chief executive officer, that is Secretary General of the UN Secretariat, and he will send that representatives on people to research and submit that report. Based on that report, the secretary will submit the report, consolidate report to the General Assembly for further decisions. And that is for second is mediating between the international disputes which is arising between countries like India and Pakistan. Like that, there are many countries who is really facing issues between their countries, not only in terms of alliances, even in terms of border, water, food, petroleum products, and many other reasons to fight each other. So in this regard, that Secretary General will definitely working on this. And coming to the another very important, he will also the person, and he will interpreting the speeches and translated the documents in the official languages of United Nations, that is English and Spanish, because the world may not speak English and French. So when the people are unable to speak on these two languages, obviously they'll express their views and ideas in their own terminology and their own language. Then later that will be translated into these two main languages, that is English as well as French. Apart from this, even the UN has given chances to speak or to submit its reports in Spanish language, Arabic language, and Hindi also. But still, many people and many countries have their own issues and they have their own status. Because of all those things, the Secretariat will not able to coordinate. So the other very important duty here is that the secretary has to translate that reports and data and he will convey and he will submit to the General Assembly. So this was the a brief information about the United Nations, its origin, aims and objectives, official languages, membership and even its organization. And friends, and this is the time to know about the achievements as well as the failures of the United Nations. In this regard, first I'll discuss about the achievements of the UN. In this regard, for the convenient, I made it like two parts. One is the political achievements, the other one is non-political, that is economic, socio, cultural and other things. In this regard, let me start with the political achievements which is achieved by the United Nations with the help of all its members. I am not saying that it is only the achievement of United Nations, but it is the achievements of togetherness, that is all together, all members countries of this United Nations has supported to achieve in various issues, especially in terms of politics. In this regard, for here I mentioned very important achievements which is achieved by this organization, that is political achievements. Under this, the Iran crisis, Indonesia, Greece, Kashmir, South Africa, Berlin, Korea, Cuba, Afghanistan, as well as Suez, water disputes. Now let me brief about each issue, how the UN has to task force to resolve the issue which was rising between the countries to for not only the water, petroleum and regional as well as the border, with all reasons, with all his efforts, I think UN has succeeded to achieve and resolve all problems between the nations. In this regard, Iran crisis, the first issue which was risen between nations, especially the oil countries in the year 1945, that is the Iran issues. Actually, Iran was one of the country where it is full of natural resources, that is petroleum products. Unfortunately, to hold ownership on that petroleum products, countries like China and America both were strongly fighting each other to hold on ownership. But here, the Iran requested to the UNO, and UNO with its support, that is peacekeeping force, entered into that Iran crisis and it's resolved like that. Even Indonesian issue, Greece issues, Kashmiri. So here let me, I'm not going to discuss and I'm not going to explain each and every issue, but here I would like to quote few issues which is very important, where the UN exactly strived to resolve the issues in this achievement. In this, I would like to share one more information about the Kashmir issues. After independence of India, regularly we have issue between India and Pakistan for one or the other reason. That reason not only in terms of border disputes, even in also it is also in terms of terrorism, even language, refuse and other things. I think in this way, the UN has tried a lot in its best, but unfortunately due to so local issues, still we are facing the issue. But still, one thing we should appreciate here, that the UN has strived a lot to resolve the issue between India and Pakistan. And coming to the Korean issues, the another very important issue. Friends, here let me quote one, that is Korea divided into North and South Korea, and they were fighting each other for the land as well as the resources. And finally, South Korea requested to the UN, and UN has interfered in these issues with the help of peacekeeping force of this UN, and finally it resolved the issues. The result of this UN interference, now there is a South Korea versus North Korea. And coming to the Suez water source, so Suez is the European channel water disputes between the European nations, especially Poland and England. There again there was an issue between these two countries, the UN interfered and resolved. Okay, these are the very few important crises which is resolved by the United Nations by its own keeping force. And coming to the non-political achievements, here again I made it like two parts. One is social achievements and other one is economic. Friends, let me explain what is exactly social. See, social means society and society related. Here after 1945, you look at the history, how countries were failing, how countries were struggling to come out from the various issues like poverty, unemployment, health issues, even the drugs control, refugees, and many other issues. Today, to come up from the all these evils, all these issues, the UN has created its own agency. For example, UNICEF, United Nations International Children's Emergency Fund, to promote the children's rights. That is child for each and every member of this world. UNESCO, United Nations Socio-Economic and Scientific Organization, to promote socio-economic and educational things. ILO, International Labour Organization, to promote labour's food. FAO, Food and Agriculture Organization, to work on and research in the agriculture field. Like that, even there is an agency for atomic energy, refugees, human rights. There are many things, and in that way, are in that through that agencies, today most of the countries are come out from the issues which is arise between the countries and other things. Coming to the second one, that is economic achievements. See, when it comes to economic, you cannot say that every member country are equally standard, every country's, you know, cost of living, standard of living, their financial status and everything is same. No, it is not that. Today, countries are developed countries are there, underdeveloped are there, even developing countries are there. Means the world is divided into three categories. One is developed country, underdeveloped, as well as developing country. See, most of the countries, especially the African and Asian continent countries, are poor countries. They are facing exactly the technical assistance. With the help of this International Atomic Energy and IMF-IBRD, the UNO is supporting to uplift the countries in terms of providing loans. See, that loans is in two terms. One is planned loans and unplanned loans. Plan means whatever they submitted and whatever they guide, according to that they should utilize the amount. That is plan. Unplanned means generally, see, for the example, to eradicate unemployment or to eradicate poverty or to create employment opportunity, this is unplanned. So because of these two, today most of the agencies are really working for the development and upliftment of the world community through various organizations and as well as the agencies of this UNO. And finally, let me to move towards the shortcomings of the or failure of the UN. Friends, till now we were discussing about the friendship and development. It is good institution, it's fine, everything is fine. At the same time, there are criticisms, there are loopholes in the organization called United Nations itself. Then what are the failures as well as the shortcomings of this agency? Here, for the study purpose, just and practically, I list outed some six failures in various aspects. In this regard, inequality. See, initially, the powerful countries, that is America, England, Russia, China, France, Italy, Germany, they were took initiative and they were the members and they were discussing everything in the General Assembly and they were sharing among all the member countries. But recently, the even other poor countries also have took membership in the UN, and unfortunately, there is no equality or there is no validity for the any opinion of the poor country. Whenever the poor countries or underdeveloping countries sharing their opinions, that time the developing countries like America or any other country, especially America and China, these two are saying that your standard of living and your other aspects are low, so we could not consider. By this way, they are demotivating. So when they demotivate, always it shows and it creates inequality among the member countries. Friends, one thing we should remember, in the beginning, the founder says that every member country of this organization are equal. Every opinion is very important. But today, practically, that's not happening. That's why today, the League of Nations, our league was failed. Same way, even United Nations is failing to, you know, maintain the equality among member countries. That's number one. Number two, veto power. Veto, as I was mentioning in the Security Council, it's a negative power. And this power is enjoying only the five permanent members of the Security Council. They are not happy to share or they are not allowing to the, you know, accept or acquire the same veto power in any other terms. So that's why that veto power is misusing. For example, India is trying to get that membership, that Security Council permanent membership, most of the time all four members are happy to sign, but whereas China is not happy, because if we become a member, that is a permanent member of the Security Council, definitely that Indian economy and Indian market will trouble to the Chinese. So that's why China is not supporting. By China's, you know, veto power, we are not become a security and as well as the permanent members of the Security Council. Coming to the third one, Cold War politics. Cold War means they were not showing that we are fighting each other, but still they have the aggression as well as the politics in the terms of diplomacy. Through that diplomats, they are creating exactly issues between the country. For example, India is okay with any country, especially China, because we are unable to produce such huge goods and services. So that various reasons, we are the permanent customer as well as the country who imports many things from the country China. But due to various reasons, and recently especially COVID and other issues, even most of the country has stopped to import the goods and services from the China. Then that leads later exactly Cold War and its politics. Coming to the fourth one, membership in the Security Council. Just I was mentioning that unless the Security Council approves, the other member country will not able to get admission, that is in terms of membership. So in this regard, the Security Council is happy to allow any member as a permanent member or the member of the UN, but they are not allowing any member country to take veto power or the permanent membership of the Security Council. That will lead to the politics among the countries. And coming to the fifth one, no confidence for small nations. Most of the time, the big countries are large countries like America, England, Germany, Japan, China, France, Poland. These are the developed countries in terms of economy as well as the industries. So that's why their word and their opinion will be considered rather than the small countries, because small countries, first of all, they are all poor, and second thing, their ideology, their development activities are little poor. So that's why they are all ignoring. So when they ignored by the developed countries, obviously they will lose the confidence among the members as well as the great agency called United Nations. And finally, the last one, which is very important, that's no interference in the domestic issues. The domestic issues may within the countries. For example, there is an issue between India and Pakistan, India within Indian issues, or crises between South Africa and other countries. Even other example, the best is Korean issues, South Korea versus North Korea. So in this case, most of the time the America interfered. So when the America interfered, countries felt that unnecessarily the UN is dominating or the US is dominating in our domestic area. When they interfere, obviously people will feel guilty and they don't want to become they don't want to continue as a member of this agency. So that's why, so these are, UN is failing in various aspects. With all this, let me conclude. See, with the great ideas, intention, and to prevent further third world war, and as well as the promote international peace and security, the leaders like Franklin Roosevelt, Winston Churchill, Joseph Mazzini, Stalin, the former president of Union Soviet Socialist Russia, they established the great institution which is today is called as the World Parliament for promoting all the activities. And it strived to develop the world in various terms with the help of its agency. But unfortunately, with the huge influence of both America as well as China, the small countries are losing the confidence in the agency itself. And that will lead to the failure. So I'm not saying that ultimately the UN is failed. UN has succeeded in various acts. I was explaining political and non-political issues. Based on this, we can prove that yes, exactly the UN has succeeded in all terms, but at the same time, it has also failed in a few aspects. That's why the countries like America or China or any other country should not interfere unnecessarily and without their knowledge. And that will lead to fail and the bossism. So, this is the ultimate. Thank you.